Thanks. It's great to be here. I've always felt that demos are a critical part of being an entrepreneur. I still have a few demos, but my role today is in wrapping up this first day of this conference is to give you a somewhat broader perspective or share my perspective on technology. So let me ask you a couple questions regarding that. Most of you are familiar with Jeopardy. If the Jeopardy query was the current president of the United States, how many of you would be able to respond to that? Raise your hands. And it would be, who is Barack Obama? Yeah. All right. How about this one? A long, tiresome speech delivered by a frothy pie topping. Anybody got that? Well, there's a couple hands going up. Maybe you've heard of it. Yeah, what is a meringue harangue? And so IBM's Watson got that right. And it wasn't just a lucky guess. It got a lot of things right. It made some stupid mistakes, but humans do also. It got a higher score than the best two human players put together. And it didn't get its knowledge by having a database that was handcrafted by the engineers. It actually sat down, figuratively speaking, and read all of Wikipedia and several other encyclopedias, 200 million pages of natural language documents. Now, you and I could read Wikipedia too. I've actually figured out it would take about 3 years at its current size. By the time we finish it, it will have doubled in size. It's not clear we could keep up with it. But more importantly, I don't know about you, but I'd forget 95% of what I read. I always feel I do that. I read along and then I figure, was I paying attention for the last five pages? Watson was able to use its total recall to remember everything it read. If you look at what Watson actually understands from any of those pages, and you can get printouts that kind of show its understanding, it's way below human levels. So there could be a page which, you know, you and I could read, and if we didn't know anything about United States politics, we would be certain that Barack Obama was president from having read that page. And Watson would say, well, there's a 59% chance that Barack Obama is president. But it will have read 200 million pages, and it's able to combine all of those probabilities, and using Shannon's theorem, is able to come out with a very high probability that Barack Obama is president, or that meringue harangue is the correct response to that second query I gave you. The point is that we're making very discernible progress in artificial intelligence. It's quite visceral, and even though I have some idea of how Watson works, and I'll talk a little bit more about that, it gave me a feeling of inspiration to actually watch it get some of the really obscure answers correct. The bottom line is we're making exponential gains in hardware and software. There was a recent study done by the Scientific Advisory Board to President Obama that compared hardware progress to software progress. Because some people get up and say, well, Kurzweil's right. Computers and communications and even genetic sequencing and other information technologies are progressing in an exponential manner, but software is stuck in the mud. And so they analyzed this issue, and they looked at all of the major scientific and engineering problem areas. So, and they found that actually software had made more progress than hardware. For example, linear programming, which is used in Watson, it's used in AI, it's actually used in the brain, and I'll talk more about that in a moment. There was progress of 1,000 to 1 over the last 15 years in hardware and being able to solve that problem. 15,000 to 1 in software for a total, since you multiply them, of 15 million to 1, with a lot more progress from improvement in software algorithms than hardware. And there are many visceral examples now. People are talking to their computers. I ask people, you know, how do you like Siri, for example, or some of the competitors to Siri, and very often they complain about it. It reminds me of the joke of this woman whose dog plays chess, and she says, And she's asked, aren't you amazed that your dog can play chess? And she goes, yeah, it's pretty amazing, but his end game is very weak. And so it's pretty amazing that people are actually talking to their computers, and it responds well enough that they keep talking to it. And the interesting thing about technology is when it first comes out, people are full of criticisms, because version one usually has some flaws. Then by the time it really works well, people go, well, it's not so interesting, that's been around for many years. But people are talking to their computers. Computer speech recognition is working actually extremely well if you've tried things like dragon dictation recently. The Google self-driving cars actually work very well if you talk to anybody who's driven in them. AI is making discernible hardware and software progress. Now, since I only have a few minutes, I thought I would write down what I was going to present. Any questions on any of this? All right, I'll go through it a little more slowly. But this group is certainly familiar with exponential growth. And so this is the progress in computation. This is a logarithmic scale. So every level on this graph is 100,000 times greater than the level that's labeled below it. So this represents trillions-fold increase, several billion-fold since I was a student. This is several billion times more powerful per constant dollar than the computer I use as a student. It's 100,000 times smaller. But the interesting thing is that this is not Moore's law. People go, oh, it's Moore's law. But this started decades before Gordon Moore was born. Shrinking components on an integrated circuit was the fifth, not the first paradigm. They were shrinking vacuum tubes in the 1950s and finally ran out of steam. They couldn't shrink them anymore and keep the vacuum. Just went to another paradigm, transistors, and then to chips. People have been talking about the end of Moore's law. The sixth paradigm that will replace Moore's law is already working in laboratories. If you talk to Justin Ratner, the CTO of Intel, he'll show you these self-organizing three-dimensional molecular circuits, which is the sixth paradigm. Already a significant fraction of chips are at least multi-layer, which is a baby step in the third dimension. That'll keep us going for a long time. But another criticism of this whole idea is, okay, well, exponentials go on for a little while, but they don't go on indefinitely. I mean, this has been going on since the 1890 census. And it's really a basic law of information technology, because we're always using the latest technology to create the next, which is why it grows exponentially. We're using the computers of 2012 to create the computers of 2014. We couldn't do that in 2002 because we didn't have computers of 2012, and so on. And we see this in many different areas. I don't have time to dwell on all of this. Our utilization of this technology, despite this 50% deflation rate, actually outstrips the 50% deflation rate. We use more than twice as much of it each year. And the reason for that, as price performance hits certain levels, we have all of you showing new apps, and wow, now with the capability of chips and communications and modular computing, we can do these applications. You know, it's not just because Mark Zuckerberg wasn't around that social networks didn't take off till, say, 4 or 5 years ago. The computational requirements, communication requirements, just were too expensive. This is bits shipped. I have 50 other graphs like this. It more than doubles. In fact, the utilization grows 18% every year in constant dollars, despite the fact you can get twice as much of it each year for the same price. And that's because of all of these new applications, which are basically launched here. So Time magazine had a cover story on this idea, and they wanted to print this exponential growth in computing. They wanted to include a particular computer that they were fond of and had talked about. And it's right on the graph. And this is the graph that I put in place in 1981 and projected it out to 2050. And we're right now in 2012, we're right where we should be. It applies to communications. From Morse code over AM radio to 4G networks today, we've seen exponential growth for a century. It applies to biological technologies. DNA sequencing, in the Genome Project, only 1% had been finished halfway through the project, and skeptics said, I told you this wasn't going to work. Here you are, 7 years into a 15-year project. You finished 1%. It's going to take 700 years, just like we said. My response was, no, we're almost done. Once you hit 1%, and it's an exponential progression, it's only seven doublings from 100%, and indeed, it doubled every year, continued to, and was done 7 years later. Physical things are becoming information technology. This is a revolution that's right before the storm, because 3D printers are still somewhat too expensive. They're still not fine enough resolution. Now, the resolution is in microns. It needs to be in hundreds of nanometers, kind of one order of magnitude greater to really get the flexibility we need. But this is, I could actually email you a violin if you had the requisite three-dimensional printer. You could print it out. But this is going to bring the world of exponential growth of information technology to the physical world. So let me spend just a few minutes on the brain. As was mentioned, I have a new book coming out, How to Create a Mind, The Secret of Human Thought Revealed. For one thing, the same exponential growth applies to our ability to see inside the brain. And the best evidence I had for my particular thesis on how the brain works came while I was writing the book over the past year, because the spatial resolution of every kind of brain scanning is doubling every year, destructive, non-destructive, non-invasive, and so on. And the simulations are scaling up exponentially. And there's really some startling research that I cite in the book that supports the thesis of the uniform algorithm of the neocortex, and I describe what that is. The neocortex is where we do our thinking. And it's a fairly recent evolutionary structure. Only mammals have one. It allows us to think in hierarchies. So we can do hierarchical thinking, and we can learn hierarchical ideas. And this was very useful for survival. So 65 million years ago, when there was this Cretaceous extinction event, which we think was caused by a meteor, those animals, like reptiles, that didn't have a neocortex and couldn't think in an exponential manner and couldn't learn new exponentially based tasks, died out. And mammals, which at that point were little rodents, kind of took over that ecological niche. And it kept growing, and a big innovation in Homo sapiens is we have this big forehead where we could squeeze in a greater quantity of neocortex. And that was enough for us to be able to do art and science and music and literature. And I'll say just a few words on how it works. It would take me 5 or 6 minutes to fully summarize the book, but for this group, we'll do it in 3 minutes. But we have 300 million pattern recognizers, and they're all actually following the same algorithm. There's total uniformity across the neocortex. And the best evidence for that is that they're interchangeable. So neuroscientists are fond of saying, okay, well, this region, the fusiform gyrus, recognizes faces, and this region, V1, recognizes shapes and edges of visual images. And when information flows in a, quote, normal way, that tends to be correct. But what happens if it doesn't flow in that way? Take a congenital blind person. There's no visual information flowing into V1. Does it sit there and do nothing? No, that region that generally deals with primitive shapes and contours and edges starts dealing with high-level language concepts. So the pattern recognizers that deal with primitive concepts and advanced, subtle, high-level concepts are actually the same. They just exist at different levels in this hierarchical structure. So to give you an example, I have a number, there's a lot of redundancy, of pattern recognizers that recognize crossbars and capital A's or in other printed characters. And so it looks around and sees a crossbar, it goes, aha, crossbar, and it fires. It's actually not firing on one axon, it's actually a whole probabilistic network, but basically it says, there's a crossbar, and a number of these pattern recognizers flow up to a higher level, and that higher level will go, aha, capital A. And then an even higher level will go, aha, the word apple, that's, or at least the printed word apple. In another part of my neocortex, there'll be a similar hierarchy, and a pattern recognizer might go, aha, an actual physical apple. And in another region, It might, another pattern recognizer will fire saying, someone just said the word apple. Go up another 20 or 30 levels, and there's a pattern recognizer that goes, oh, that was funny. She's pretty. That was ironic. Now, you probably think that those are much more sophisticated and complicated than the lower ones, but they're actually exactly the same. There was an open brain surgery on this young girl, and whenever they stimulated a particular point in the neocortex, she started to laugh, and they thought they must be triggering some kind of laugh reflex, but they quickly realized they were actually triggering the perception of humor. Whenever they triggered the spot, she just found everything hilarious. You guys are so funny just standing there was a typical comment. Now, she's obviously got more than one point in her neocortex that recognizes humor, but we actually have these pattern recognizers. And a fundamental issue is that we have a limited number of them. We have 300 million by my estimate. Is that a big number or a little number? Well, it was big enough, as I said, to allow humans, unlike any other species, to create language and technology and demos and science and art. But it's also very limited. And I struggle with these limitations every day. It takes so long to read a book. There's so little of human knowledge that we can personally master. It would be great to expand it. And that is where the future is headed. AI, I mean, I'm personally involved in this right now, to create AI based on these principles. It actually goes back to work that I was pioneering in the 80s and 90s, something called hierarchical hidden Markov models. Which are organized in these kind of hierarchies, and we actually did natural language understanding and speech recognition using these techniques. And interestingly, at that time, it wasn't that we used them because, that's how the brain works. We had no idea how the brain works because we couldn't see inside the brain at that time with enough precision. But the techniques that evolved in the biological brain actually are the same techniques that have evolved in the world of AI, just because they work. And we now have the computational resources to do this at a very high level. And Watson's a very good example. But in terms of practical applications, consider how fantastic search engines are. I mean, imagine life without search engines. It sounds like ancient history, but that was only a little over a decade ago. But they're still based, they're very clever, and they can understand some things about words and synonyms, and there's some natural language understanding a little bit, but they're fundamentally still based on words as indexes into documents. Imagine a search engine that could really understand and read everything on the web. There's actually not as much as you might think. There's only about 10 billion pages, and it's quite feasible. I mean, Watson read 200 million pages. It's quite feasible to read all of that. And to actually understand it. And I'll give you one quick scenario, and then we'll go to the dialogue. We really don't want to waste time asking a search engine. We want these personal assistants to be like a friend that kind of follows you around. So Google Bounce is a good example of that. It makes sure that you get to places on time. It'll say, hey, you know, you better leave for that appointment in Palo Alto now because there was an accident on the 280. And that's what Bounce does. Well, it just deals with your appointments and traffic patterns and maps and so on. But that should also apply to the world of knowledge and to world of language. So if it knows you're interested in cancer stem cells and whether or not they can survive anaerobic conditions, it'll tell you, oh, there was a great paper that just came out an hour ago that talks about the effect of anaerobic conditions on cancer stem cells. Or just listen in on your conversations, either verbal or written, and watch what you're reading, and pop up answers to questions that you haven't formulated yet. I think that's where we're headed. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ray. I've got the honor to have about 15 minutes or so with Ray. That was a great presentation. The first questions that I had on this was, you've got such a complex set of technologies in the brain itself, and you've been on the forefront of analyzing this. What are the ways we can take that understanding and feed that back into technology, the designing of chips and other technologies?
Well, technology is going to become more and more intelligent. I mean, all the apps, you can see that already in apps being presented here. As we move forward, they're going to be based on an understanding of the world of knowledge, particularly that we've written down. I mean, our first invention was language, so we could tell stories and tell people what happened to you today, and stories became codified, but they would drift over time, so we invented written language, and we now have computers that can store and search that written language, otherwise we could never keep track of it. But we really need to do that conceptually, to have computers actually understand those documents. And there are many different types of applications. I mentioned one at the end of my talk. But I see that's where technology is headed. Applications that will be listening into you and really understanding what you're saying. You can, I mean, a number of the demos we saw today, it'd be good to be able to actually ask for help or for the application to do something based on a natural language statement.
Can you talk a little bit about the project that you're working on? You're being a little furtive on the details, but if maybe one analogy is Google Glass that I think a lot of the people in the audience can relate to. We've seen a lot of publicity on it where you have some glasses and then you have some information that pops up.
Google Glass is a good example of the coming of augmented reality. And I think we'll be in augmented reality all the time. So, right now we have devices. This is too big, actually, because it weighs down my jacket, but it's also too small. I walk around every day with this very large, expansive display, which is real reality, my visual field of view. That should be our display. So you can either display information, overlay it on the real world, or actually augment the real world. Just being able to be told what someone's name is, that would be very helpful. That's a killer app, which is coming. And then, of course, to give you more background about people and places and things, give you just walking directions, even in a building. But to be constantly overlaying the real world, listening in your conversation. So to build on the idea I mentioned earlier, there'd be little pop-ups. If it sees you're struggling to find some name of an actress, that would pop up with some background about her and a picture. And you'll just get used to this assistant helping you. And it would be second nature that you expect this information to pop up in your visual field of view. And we'll get dependent on it very quickly. I'm already dependent on the mind expanders. When we had that one day SOPA strike, I felt like a part of my mind had gone on strike. Because people did figure out how to get around it, but it showed the tremendous dependence we have on these brain extenders we have already.
Right. Now the Google guys, just to finish on the glass analogy, Google guys have talked for a long time about having that chip in the brain, to be able to search things you're looking for, like the name that you forgot.
Right. Well, I don't think it'll be a chip. I mean, if you look at the, these are getting smaller and smaller. This 25 years from now, this will be the size of a blood cell, and there are already devices that are extremely tiny that are being put inside human bodies. Right now, it requires us some kind of medical condition. Although there's some that are non-invasive that you can just swallow. There are also some devices you can put in the bloodstream of animals, one cured type 1 diabetes in rats. If you go out 25 years, we'll have pretty sophisticated computerized robotic devices in our blood cell. They can go inside the brain, interact non-invasively with your biological neurons, act as a gateway then to the cloud, so basically expand your brain into the cloud, and for one thing, give you more neocortex. So why be limited to 300 million panorecognizers? How about a billion or a trillion? And
so would you be working with them? I mean, would you be working on a project in tandem with Google? Do you see them competing as platforms? Just wondering if you have a critique of what they're doing.
Well, I think Google is very well oriented towards adding intelligence to search and to all of their activities. They have some obvious AI projects like the driverless cars, and they have a tremendous interest in this area. It's always been my orientation not to start big companies myself, but to build a technology and then find a good home for it. So my first company, Kurzweil Computer Products, is now Nuance, which is provides a lot of the technology for Siri and is a leader in speech recognition. So I do hope to create technology based on the insights that I have, not only from the book, but what we've discovered about the brain is it's using techniques that are mathematically very similar to techniques which we've used in AI, and which I actually helped pioneer in the 80s and 90s.
Right. So yeah. So Ray, you formed the company that eventually became Nuance, and Nuance is used, just as you were saying, by Siri, and I think most speech recognition companies. I think Watson is also using it, if I'm not mistaken. Siri has been criticized by some to be a little slow, not perfect. Some people have given up on it. Can you talk about where that's going, and maybe critique where you see the current technology and perhaps uses to advance that somehow?
Well, I think actually the natural language understanding in Siri is fairly weak. That needs a lot of improvement. I think that's feasible. I think some of the ideas I'm pursuing will provide that. I just think it's interesting as a threshold. Actually, for a version one product, it's pretty good. Because usually version one doesn't work at all. And people do still use Siri.
You said you're pursuing natural language technology to improve that?
Yeah.
Okay. Is the brain growing over time? I mean, can you talk a little bit about, you were just referring to how you were limited. You felt like you take an hour to read a book, and that's really frustrating, right? How can we augment our brain? I'm just wondering, is it growing over time, and what are the things we can do to augment?
Well, it actually doesn't grow much from a very young age. There are what I call, there are these modules that are these 300 million pattern recognizers. There's interesting research that shows that connections inside one of these modules, which I estimated about 100 neurons, is stable and doesn't change. It's the connections between the modules that evolve. And we pretty much have those 300 million at a very young age. One of the reasons that kids can learn languages or learn anything, music, so quickly and readily is they've not filled up those 300 million pattern recognizers with concepts. And so it's virgin territory to absorb all of these insights. A key thing is by the time we're even 20, we've filled it up, we need to be able to intelligently and selectively destroy information to learn new information. And we need to be able to repurpose our neocortex to learn something new. People who have a rigid process for holding on to old information and not being willing to accept new information are going to have difficulty doing that. But I think actually at any age you can learn new material even as quickly as a child. But you have to be able to kind of move on. Now there's a dynamic process. You don't have to completely unlearn something. You can keep a certain amount of it. Where there's a lot of redundancy, you can reduce the redundancy and learn new material. But there is a limited capacity, and I think ultimately that's one of the things we're going to overcome by basically expanding our brains into the cloud.
Can you talk a little bit about that, expanding your brains into the cloud? Because that's something I'm sure a lot of people would like. I mean, if you could, if Einstein could have expanded his brain and done a lot more than just science, you've talked about how he was a violinist, but he could play the violin, but he wasn't a violinist. I mean, you could do anything you wanted to do.
Well, we already have profound brain extenders. I mean, just the fact that we can search all of human knowledge. And search engines are already, quite impressive and have codified knowledge in databases like Wikipedia and all of the myriad other brain extenders we have is fantastic. We are smarter. I mean, I've been managing work groups for 45 years, and I can have a group of three or four people do something in 3 weeks, which used to take 50 people 3 years. I mean, I can see that. And I can see it in myself as I write books and the process I used to have to go through. as they get more intelligent, that's type of brain expansion, even if it's not physically inside my body and brain, is going to get more and more sophisticated. I think that's an arbitrary distinction whether they put something inside or not. But ultimately, it will go inside. We will expand these 300 million pattern recognizers because we will be able to actually recreate them functionally to do exactly what they do in our brain and learn. And quantity results in a different quality. So the, you know, a ape or a chimpanzee is close to a human but doesn't have as much neocortex as we do, particularly because of our frontal cortex. That additional quantity resulted in the qualitative leap of philosophy and language and art and science and technology. So when we expanded it again, which is what I think we will do, we can't even describe what that next qualitative leap will be. I mean, how could somebody without language describe what the world of language would be like? And so we're going to make qualitative leaps by being able to expand our neocortex. And we'll do it directly from the brain. And it will be in the cloud because that's where all interesting things happen. I mean, even if you use a mobile device to translate, to search for something like Siri, it's not done in the phone. It's done out in the cloud. And so that's, you know, we will expand our brains into the cloud.
Great. So, yeah, you were saying earlier that you know, you couldn't do certain things in 2002 because you needed the machines of 2012 to be able to do them. I wanted to ask a question on behalf of the entrepreneurs in the room. In your view, since your brain, I presume, is limited and you can only do a few of these cool projects, what are the empty spaces that we can work on that maybe in 2012 that we can begin to go work on to as entrepreneurs to go create value in as you know to build companies. I'm just wondering what.
Well, I think something that is coming is an ability. There's been a lot of discussion of big data, but big data is not just numerical tables or alphanumeric tables. Most of the interesting information is natural language that exists on Facebook pages and on blogs, and not to mention all the more organized material like encyclopedias and the ability to actually understand the page, even if it's not quite at human levels. And that we won't get to until 2029, because that's the Turing test, and that's been my date. And you know, there's reasons actually to be optimistic and say maybe it'll happen sooner, but I haven't officially changed that position. But what I think we will have over the next few years is an ability to get meaningful information from natural language documents that's more than just playing tricks with whether or not there's certain words and proximity with each other, and to actually get into the semantic structure of natural language documents. And that, I mean, many of the applications that are discussed here could benefit from, you know, some intelligent understanding of natural language.
Can you explain again why it's going to take so long? I mean, we've seen these efforts time and again. I mean, we saw a company called PowerSet 3 or 4 years ago that tried to say that they could do semantics in natural language search. They were bought by Microsoft. A lot of people were laughing at their claims that they could do this. They've solved the riddle, and they were saying, well, they actually had made some progress. Why is it going to take so long to do some?
Well, I don't. I mean, I didn't see natural language understanding technology from PowerSet. I mean, they had some things that could do tricks with summarizing documents by doing sort of certain analyses of where long words were. And you really have to approach it the way the human brain approaches, with a hierarchical approach. And language is hierarchical, just like the human brain, which is no coincidence, because the human brain created language. It was our first technology, our first invention. And it reflects very much the structure of the neocortex. And you have to build it that way. And a key part of the technology is learning. Even if you did a perfect job of functionally simulating the neocortex, it wouldn't do anything unless you educated it. Just like a newborn, you know, does have a evolutionary ability to be very cute, which is a survival instinct, but you know, it's not going to hold a conversation with you. And it learns concepts one layer at a time. And it's got to lay down a whole layer of understandings, say, of primitive shapes and sounds, and then it can do the next layer. And as adults, we do that too. We have to learn certain prerequisites till we can learn the next layer of science or technology. And we're going to have to educate these synthetic neocortexes the same way. Now, we don't have to take 20 years. We can speed up that process. But that's not incidental. I mean, that is core. I mean, just as we focus on education for humans, we're going to have to focus on education for these synthetic neocortexes. We can't just let it loose on hundreds of millions of pages. But they did do that with Watson and got it up to a point where it does a subhuman level, but it can then combine that level of understanding with the tremendous scale and speed and total recall of computers. Because then it could take that understanding and actually apply it consistently to 200 million pages of documents.
I've got a final question for you. We're unfortunately out of time. Ethics. Some people have argued that there's been no progress at all in human civilization despite our massive amounts of knowledge. And others have argued that there is progress, and somehow we have advanced as humans. What is your, you know, with your understanding of where the brain is going, how about ethics in terms of
are they getting better? There's two big questions there, which we could take a whole conference on each one, but...
We got 1 minute.
Yeah. I would certainly say we have made progress, thanks to communication technologies. It started with things like the printing press, and the printing press and the kind of early spread of democracy happened around the same time. And we now see the democratic impact of social networks like Facebook. And so it's a long discussion, but I would say that human beings, being assisted by our ever-increasing and exponentially growing communication technologies, have become more democratic and more representative of the values which this country celebrates. There is an issue, kind of a different issue in AI, which is the whole friendly versus unfriendly AI issue. Technology has always been a double-edged sword. I mean, is fire a good thing? It kept us warm. It cooks our food. It was also used to burn down our villages. Technology has been a double-edged sword ever since fire and stone tools and the wheel. AI can also be dangerous. There are plenty of science futures and movies that make that point. Usually, I think the fallacy in those movies is that the AI is out there and it's something, someone else, something else. What I see already is that AI is very widely distributed. And it's not just in some dark lab of a government somewhere. A kid in Africa with a smartphone has access to more intelligent information than the President of the United States did 15 years ago. It's a very empowering capability. It's democratized creativity. So a kid in Africa, and certainly millions of people here, can create technologies and come to this conference and demo them. But it could also be used for destructive purposes. If you have an AI that's more intelligent than you are and it's bent for your destruction, that's a bad situation to be in. And the only way you could protect yourself would be to get some AI allied with you that's more intelligent than it. And if it turns on you, well, then you'd need to get even smarter AI. There are answers to this. I mean, this is actually not a specter today in AI, but it is a specter today in biotech. The same technologies we're using to reprogram biology away from cancer and disease could be used by a bioterrorist right today to reprogram a virus like flu or the cold to be more deadly, more communicable, and create a super weapon. I've actually worked with the US Army on developing a rapid response system for that. That's one kind of broad category of ways to deal with it. Having ethical guidelines to prevent abuse, which we have called the Asilomar guidelines, it's another approach. So it's a more complicated issue that we can describe in 1 minute. But I think between ethical standards and rapid response systems to identify dangers is the answer. And we can take, I think, comfort from how well we've done with one kind of evolving threat, which is software viruses. The software viruses have gotten more and more sophisticated, and nobody can cross them off our list and say, oh, well, software viruses, that's not a problem anymore. But it hasn't shut down the internet. Nobody says, well, the problem is so bad, let's just scrap all computers and start over. We clearly get far more benefit than harm. And we have an evolving technological immune system that's been able to keep up with the problem, more or less. And you can have arguments about it, but I think it's basically working. That's a prototype for how we need to deal with these issues.
Great. Thank you, Ray. I will not ask you about intelligence in space. Thank you very much, Ray.